Hello and good morning. It's Wednesday, week 7, and we're back with more news and entertainment.
We will be covering the latest news from Paris, a city still in shock after a terrorist attack on Friday.
We will also be joined by the winners of Jailbreak, Alex and Kate, and the CCO Media and Communications, Ben Kay, to talk about the Lusu elections and the news.
Stay tuned for Good Morning Lancaster. Welcome back, I'm Jack Hill.
And I'm Siri Hamperpour. On Monday, students held a gathering in Alexandra Square to pay their respects to those who lost their lives in the terrorist attack on Paris and the terrorist attacks in Beirut and Baghdad. Let's take a look.
Hello. I'd like to start by saying you that, first of all, I would like to thank you for so massively reacting to what happened on Friday. I speak in the name of all of us while saying we're all shocked. In these brief words, we would like to express our deepest sympathies toward the families' victims. What happened on Friday is not the first attempt of division that the French people have been confronted to this year. However, these acts are not only France's problem. This concerns everybody. It's not only about our country, it's about humanity. We all need to stay united, to support each other, to help each other out, to not being afraid. Once again, these attacks aim to divide us with mottos such as fear, death, and destruction. Our only response will be unity, love, and solidarity. In these times of darkness, the three words of liberté, égalité, fraternité shall resonate in our hearts and minds and light up our ways through these obscure times. Stay strong, stay united, together as one. Thank you. A minute of silence to show our respect for not only France's victim, but the victims from all around the world from different attacks that occurred this weekend. Thank you.
L'étendard sanglant élevé, entendez-vous dans nos campagnes mugir ces féroces soldats qui viennent jusque dans nos bras, égorger nos femmes et nos compagnes. Aux armes, citoyens, formez vos bataillons, marchons, marchons. 1500 impurs abreuvent le sillon.
Thank Thank you for the support shown. And now I propose that you guys help us French people singing your national anthem, God Save the Queen.
God save our gracious Queen, long live our noble Queen, God save the Queen. Send her victorious, happy and glorious, long to reign over us, God save.
Let's bring you up to date with the news headlines. Terror returns to Paris. Breaking news this morning as armed police have raided a flat in the North Paris suburb of Saint-Denis. Two people have reportedly been killed, including a woman who blew herself up with a suicide belt. The operation began at around 4:30 local time this morning as explosions and gunfire was heard. Five people have reportedly been arrested as the deputy mayor has urged residents to stay indoors.
This news follows Friday's attacks where 129 people were killed and more than 350 people injured in a series of terrorist attacks across the French capital. At least eight suicide bombers targeted the National Stadium, a concert hall, bars and restaurants. French security sources say that a surveillance video shows a possible ninth assailant.
The worst bloodshed was at a rock concert where more than 80 people were taken hostage and shot dead. The attacks have been described by President Francois Hollande as an act of war. The president declared a national state of emergency and has restricted the movement of people across the country's borders.
Gunfire on the streets. Three coordinated teams appear to have been behind the attacks, according to Paris chief prosecutor Francois Mollins. French police have carried out more than 150 raids across the country as the search for suspects continues.
Raids have also been taking place in the Belgian city of Brussels. French warplanes have pounded Raqqa, ISIL's de facto capital, in response to the attacks last Friday.
Numerous countries have shown solidarity to France by illuminating the flag colours upon their country's landmarks. Individuals themselves have also shown solidarity by changing their profile pictures on Facebook to include the French flag.
Germany's international friendly against Holland was called off at late notice last night amid fears it would be targeted by terrorists. The match in Hanover was due to begin at 7:45 GMT, but a security alert saw police step in around 6 p.m. to prevent it from taking place.
Back on campus, Lancaster University Pharmacy is moving to the centre of campus from its current location in Bailrigg House. Its new home will be in the middle of the spine next to Boland College and Subway. This new location is hoped to make visits to the pharmacy more convenient for students and staff alike.
Jailbreak is over. 40 teams took part in the event to raise money for charity, the charity Enactus, and together travelled 16,500 kilometres. Six teams made it across the channel and the winners, the Bloody Welsh, travelled an amazing 1,300 kilometres to Austria. Almost 9,000 has been raised so far and we'll be joined by the winners a little later in the programme.
Nominations are open for all JCR and CCO positions. Be prepared for an exciting week ahead as people start campaigning heavily. Questions will be asked, candidates will get exhausted, but it's shaping out to be a great 2 weeks.
Also in week 8, we will see the referendum on the BDS movement take place. It is a simple yes or no vote. If you don't know about it, please take the time to read up on it. And we'll have coverage on Monday with LA World TV streaming live.
Here in Lancaster, the World at Lancaster extravaganza, hosted by the Students' Union, has started this week. The event brings together Lancaster's global community to celebrate and share the international opportunities we have here on campus. Let's take a look.
You gotta go and get angry at all of my honesty. You know I try, but I don't do too well with apologies. I hope I don't run out of time, cause someone call a referee. Cause I just need one more shot, have forgiveness. I know you know that I made those mistakes maybe once or twice.
by once or twice, I mean maybe a couple of hundred times. So let me, oh let me redeem, oh redeem all myself tonight. Cause I just need one more shot, second chance. Yeah. Is it too late now to say sorry? Cause I'm missing more than just your body. Take every single piece of the blame if you want me to. But you know that there is no innocent one in this game for two. I go, and then you go out and spill the truth. Can we both say the words and forget this? Yeah, is it too late now to say sorry? Yeah, I know that I let you down. Is it too late to say I'm sorry now?
We are now joined by CCO Media and Communications, Ben Kay. Welcome, Ben.
Hello, how are you guys?
Good.
It's looking good so far. I'm loving it. Yeah, it's great. Yeah.
We'll talk to you about the Lucio elections that have been in our news and they're starting. When are they starting, Ben?
The nominations have opened. They open on Monday at 10 a.m. They will close at Friday on Friday at 4. Mm-hmm. So you have a whole week for anyone who wants to nominate themselves to nominate for any positions. All JCR and CCO positions are opened up, as well as some LUSU councillor positions.
Okay.
LUSU's NUS delegates for the National Union of Students Conference.
Yep.
Couldn't get that words out. Uh-huh. So if you want to run, please feel free to run. You're more than welcome. Everyone should run. Uh-huh. It is a brilliant experience. Stressful, but it's fun. It's worth it. Do it.
So can absolutely anybody run for any position?
Yeah, so you can only run for one JCR position, mm-hmm. and you can only run for one CCO position.
Okay.
So you can still run for, say, a comms officer in a college and a CCO position if you wanted to. It's more than acceptable to do that, but you can't run for more than one CCO position.
Okay.
So you can't run for two CCO positions. Like there was someone who appeared on the board, if anyone was watching, you know who you are. Ran for putting his name on every position, and you can't do that. So if that happens, you just won't be allowed to enter the actual round of elections. So although it's a little, might be a little bug in the system, when it actually comes to the elections going up, if you've done that, then obviously you won't be able to run for anything at that point. Or they might contact you, I don't know. Can't say police on that one.
So when people are elected, like when do they step into their positions?
So the term will start from the start of next term.
Next term.
And they will do a year. So although elections are opening now, current JCRs are still in office until the end of this term.
Right.
Okay.
And at the start of term two, LUSU put on two, three days of training. Mm-hmm. Where anyone can come down who is an elected officer and they teach you all sorts of stuff. It's a really interesting conference, what they do. It used to be called Winter Officer Training. What? I think it's changed now to JOT, January Officer Training, because the plan is to spread it over the year a little bit, just in case people can't make it back, especially like with international students flying in. Obviously, flights are probably already booked for coming back to
term. Yeah, of course.
Because obviously it's cheaper the earlier you book it. So it's quite possible that they might not be able to make it back. So there are talks of spreading that training throughout the year as well.
It'd be handy, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
make it more convenient.
If people step down as well,
yeah.
The issue is then when you go into a position, you don't receive any training on it.
Yeah.
That's always been a bit of an issue. So you sit there and you go, I don't know how to hold meetings. I don't know what I'm doing. So that, it's a bit, little bit to tackle that as well, I believe. Yeah.
Is there numerous positions within colleges? Like you have numerous kind of the same kind of position yeah. but for different colleges,
yeah.
don't you?
So every college is slightly different.
Yeah.
Everyone is different.
Obviously,
no,
you're Grisdale.
Yeah, obviously. Flying the flag. That's why we're on the top. Grisdale. To make people run for elections, guys, please. Yeah. But it breaks down to a very basic president, vice president. You have a welfare team of some form,
yeah.
a socials team of some form, comms teams and socials teams. Not social, sorry, sports.
Sports
is the only one that isn't ran now. Most sports run over at the end of the summer holidays.
Right.
Don't know why that is. It's just always been a thing, as far as I'm aware, that sports runs at the end of the year,
okay.
which I think is a lot to do with roses.
It probably will be.
Yeah.
I think that's why it is, because obviously roses comes very quickly.
Yeah.
A little bit too quickly for someone who's only just entered a position. You need to be a bit more, I've done this for a while now, let's see what we can do,
yeah.
kind of thing.
What do you do, Ben? What's your position?
I am in Grisdale as Vice President for Welfare.
Uh-huh.
And obviously I'm CCO Media as well,
yeah.
which is something I took up over summer.
Right.
So I know how hard it is not to have that training.
yeah.
Because you sit there and you go, I went for it because I figured I want that, like no one ran for it last year. It's not a very sought after position because it's not, as people call, hardcore.
Okay.
I think it's hardcore.
You do a lot of work
yeah.
there.
I love it.
You're constantly working for them.
So. It was never, no one ran for it. So I was like, well, go on then, I'll do it. I'm like, it sounds interesting to me, I'll go for it. So I put in for it, and obviously the elections went and I got it. And then it was an issue at the time, which they're addressing now, obviously, like I said, where I didn't have the training because obviously I wasn't there from January.
Yeah.
So it's if you're going to do it, do it now.
Do it now.
Do it
so
now.
So what do you think of getting involved? Or
I don't know, maybe later on, maybe yeah. my second year, but definitely not as a fresher.
Get settled first.
Yeah,
would
I mean,
be a good idea.
Do you see that freshers are putting themselves up for JCR and CCO
yeah,
positions?
They do. They really do get involved, to be honest. Like I went for my, it was my first year last year when I ran for VP for Grisdale, and I would advise anyone to do it. Like, if anything, do it in your freshers year.
Oh, right.
If you're a freshman, you're watching
Bit of
this,
advice.
Just do it. Like, it's worth the experience. You get so much out of it.
You get involved with the whole college, don't you?
Yeah, and you find out how everything works as well, which is what really drew me to it, is the inner workings and how it's all connected and how it just branches into this huge organisation beyond you. And it's so worth just having your little bit and your little part in that and making something great.
Yeah.
So it's better to start earlier rather than later?
No, I wouldn't say that. I'd say you can start whenever you want.
Yeah.
Like, if you're a final year and you want to do it, still do it. It's worth it. No matter what you do, you'll have a great experience. But you don't have to be here for 2 years to do it.
Yeah.
So you don't have to have that background. You'll learn it.
Yeah.
And you'll pick it up so quickly because you just get involved and it is fun.
Nice. Well, thank you, Ben.
No.
Thanks.
Could you tell us if you're going to be running for anything?
Not at this stage. So if I was to nominate myself, if I had said no, that I was running for a position,
mm-hmm.
that would then class as campaigning.
Okay.
Now, campaigning can only start once they've had... So once nominations close, there is normally a meeting within the college or within the union for CCO positions about what they can and can't do. And then at that point, they will set a time and a day where campaigning can start.
All right.
So until then, you cannot campaign in any way.
Okay.
So even if I was, I couldn't say.
You couldn't tell us.
Yes. any postering and stuff like that, if you do a poster, you have to get it approved.
Right.
So every college will have what they call a returning officer,
mm-hmm.
which is normally, depends what college it is. It could be GenSec, it could be Finance and Democracy, under that kind of banner of rule where unless they're rerunning. If they're not rerunning, they'll be the returning officer.
Okay.
So you would have to submit your poster to them. They would have to approve it to you. They will send over this little banner that you can put on the bottom of your poster. It's a proper Lusu official banner to say, yeah, this poster has been approved. And then that poster can then get printed and posted. You'd have to do a little budget that you have to submit to them before you can start campaigning as well, which is, it sounds horrific.
There's a lot of steps involved. There's
yeah,
a lot to do.
It's not, it's
very official.
It's quite a straightforward process when you're in it, but don't be scared by the process. So like, you have to have a little budget, and it sounds absolutely daunting. And I sat there and went, what? And they literally went, just put down £8 for posters.
£8 for posters.
And whatever you want, pay for £2. Because you have like a £10 budget. If it's JCO, £20 budget. If it's CCO.
Right.
And FGOs, when they run in Easter, they have a £30 budget.
Okay.
So that's the most you can spend. And that's to make it fair on everyone across the board. Yeah. So even if someone had an awful lot of money spare, which I don't think any of us do, but there will be some people out there that do. I wish I did.
Yeah, don't we all?
Need some money. It's to make it so that everyone has like a flat line budget.
Fair chance.
And that's what you can spend. In respect, last year when I did it, I had hundreds of black and white posters left over.
Oh, did you?
Because you can get quite a lot of posters black and white, because they're not... They're quite expensive, I think, for a piece of paper, but in terms of £10, it doesn't take up that much.
No.
So I think people quite often overestimate how many posters they need, and they print a lot more posters than they really
posters require. For everyone.
Yeah, there's posters everywhere. Yeah. I've probably still got loads in my room left over from last year. I'd give a bit of advice with campaigning, just funny. Like, try and do something funny, something nice, something that people can, like, oh yeah, that I like that.
Yeah.
As long as it's not offensive, it'll be absolutely.
I suppose it makes
fine.
It memorable as well, if it's something that's funny.
Like, think of all the adverts, like, probably the adverts that stick in your mind are the funny ones.
The funny ones, yeah.
Yeah.
Sounds good. Well, thank you, Ben. No problem. Good luck to anybody that takes part.
Okay, so thank you for joining us, Ben. As we mentioned earlier, jailbreak is now over and all 40 teams have finally made it back to Lancaster. Let's take a look at the highlights of Jailbreak 2015.
I'm Chris Osborne.
And I'm Sabra El-Bakeri. It's day two of jailbreak and our 40 teams are well on their way. Two teams have already crossed the channel, with others currently crossing or scheduled to cross on ferries this afternoon.
We're now joined by Simon Mohammed from Anactus. Hello. Hello, how's it going?
Yeah, not bad, how are you?
Good, not too bad. Good. We've seen loads of Snapchats come in from the teams
so far.
I think we can put a couple of them on the screen for us to have a quick look at. Now, this is the first one. I don't know if you can actually see these.
Oh.
Yay for free tickets to London, so that's pretty good. Where do you expect the teams to have got to at this stage?
Well, basically, they won the free tickets to London because they raised the most money before the start of the event. So we like offer out prizes to whoever raises the most money, but for those, I don't think they're doing too well at the moment. They got a bit stuck in London.
In London,
I think.
Right?
Yeah, it's a bit hard to get out of London. I did it last year, so I kind of know the deal.
But now I think we can go live to Jack Hill, who is one of the team members. Jack, can you hear me?
Yeah, Jack? I can.
Hello, Jack. How are you?
Hi, I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Good, very well, thank you. Whereabouts are you at the moment?
We're currently sat in Portsmouth, the port. We've got a ferry that's going to somewhere called Cannes in France. It's not like the South France Cannes, but it's somewhere else called Cannes.
Brittany, isn't it? I think.
Yeah, so we're getting across there. Our ferry's at 3:15, and they were quite excited. The ferry company paid for our tickets, so it's really nice of them.
Oh, did they? Let's give them a name check. Who is it? Which is the ferry company that's been nice and paid for you?
It was Brittany Ferries.
Brittany Ferries. Well, it's all about having a great social
media presence, and they were really nice. So,
brilliant. And I believe we've actually might have them on the phone now. Hello, Kate and Alex. Can you hear us?
Hello.
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 Hi.
How are you doing?
Good. Good. We've pulled over. We've been pulled over now for about 2 hours. Just trying to catch up on some of the sleep that we've missed over the last 2 days.
So where exactly are you guys now?
We're not exactly sure. It's roughly where it's plotted on the map. We stopped in, I don't know why, we stopped in some Christmas fair for about an hour.
So was the Snapchat that said stopped off for some Christmas shopping, was that you guys?
Yeah, that was us, yeah.
Yeah, we just had a look at that. It looks really good there, actually.
So let's see the progression of the team. The winner, the first team, is the Bloody Welsh. They succeeded to go to Austria. As we can see on the map, we can actually see the track from here. The second team and the third team, Double Trouble, and the third team, Team FAC, the people we just had on the phone before, they succeeded to go to France. The first one is La Roche-sur-Yon. And the third one is in Saumur. Only 50 kilometers separate the second team and the third team. And the last team, the loser of this game, I'm so sorry for them, and this is actually a bit sad. It's the Pussy Magnet. They just succeed to go to Preston. You all know where is Preston, but I'm just going to show you the track. So I really don't know what was the plan. I really don't know if they had a plan or something. But even if it's sad, we have to say congratulations to them because at least they tried. So this is the most important thing.
When does the weekend end for you?
Well, the next week we've kind of got things like adding up totals, sorting out prizes, a presentation even the week after. The weekend kind of ends for me at the end of the day, hopefully.
When do you stop tracking the teams?
Oh, we stop tracking them probably about 5 p.m. Well, when we know everyone's travel details back, you know, when people have made arrangements, there's kind of no need for us anymore. Yeah. You know, we don't take any liability for them after the 36 hours, so yeah.
Well, it's great to know that you've enjoyed your time and you're going to bed fairly early tonight, I would suspect, to try and catch up on a good night's sleep.
Yeah, definitely. Need it.
Thank you very much to everyone for watching the Jailbreak shows. As we've said, this is a huge fundraising effort for Enactus. It makes a massive difference to their activities throughout the year. And the fundraising link is still live for another week to try and help them reach that £9,000. Please go onto their website.
Welcome to Alex and Kate from the Bloody Welsh who won Jailbreak 2015 and making it all the way to Austria. How was the experience for you?
It was quite tiring in general. on the way out, it was brilliant. The first sort of half of it.
Yeah.
It was really quite nice, quite freeing because
there was no destination. No, yeah. We could just go wherever. So.
But then once we kind of got halfway through Saturday, we kind of thought, right, we've got to get back.
Yeah. Don't want to get too far.
So literally, we were trying to work out where we should sort of stop to make it easiest to get back, and it got kind of like, oh, well, if we do this, then we can get to here, and like, we had to really think about it, and it got quite kind of busy at that point.
Yeah.
But other than that, like, it was really, really quite enjoyable.
Yeah, run us through your movements. Like, where did you get off to a good start? Where did you head first?
Yeah, we had a very good start, actually.
Yeah, well, we did and we didn't. When we got to, like, the starting point, we realised everybody else was kind of much more prepared than us.
Yeah.
Like, they had, like, huge signs and they were all kind of laminated and cling film to stop getting wet, and
like,
we hadn't made a sign yet.
Yeah.
So we rushed back to our house to make a sign.
Also,
I forgot my hat, so I grabbed my hat, and so once we got back to the house, we made a sign and we went outside, and we were lucky enough to find there was a university student, Jemima, who gave us our first lift just to the service station. It's quite fortunate because when we were in the car, I think it was whoever the Where's Wally people were that were literally just there, so I think if we'd have spent any longer making a sign,
we probably
got the
start you got.
And then it was literally, we didn't wait more than 5 minutes.
No, we found a woman called Dee who was going to North Wales, so she dropped us off just before she turned off. And then we met a guy called Eddie who was going all the way down to Brighton, so we were like, perfect.
Yeah, yeah. So. But by the time we met Eddie, our sign had disintegrated in the,
yeah.
in the rain.
Yeah. Behind.
Yeah, so it's quite fortunate that he was taking us that far because that was it then.
Yeah.
And then it was, whilst we were in the car, with Eddie sort of going around the M25. We were just about to get off because we didn't want to go all the way to Brighton because we thought, well, if we go to Brighton,
we're
then that's
going to be stuck there.
We're going to be stuck in Brighton. We want to try and hopefully cross the channel. And so when we were on the M25, we were like, oh, can you stop just before you come off at the service station? And then just as we were sort of looking for the service station to stop at, we got a text sort of saying, well, at first it was saying, this has happened in Paris. Mm-hmm. Try and avoid it if you can. Like, try and sort of stay.
Yeah, they were quite good at sending texts out, weren't they, to avoid France.
And then literally as we were pulling off motorway onto the service station, bearing in mind, we were almost committed going to, Dover as our destination was kind of committed. Yeah. We were already on the way. And we got the text sort of saying, France has closed its borders. Sort of try not, you know, no longer available to go into France. You can try other ports or you can try airports. Yeah. And so we stood then, well, we went into the service station and kind of
debated whether we go to Heathrow.
Debated for ages. And then Olivia, who was like, I think she's the president of Enactus.
Yes, she is. Yeah.
She called us and she was like, where are you now? And we were, I think it was Chebham service station. And she was like, oh, well, that's right next to Heathrow. And so we considered going to Heathrow for ages, and we kind of thought, well, what's the likelihood that we're going to get a lift? And then my sister works for BA, so she lives next to Heathrow. So I sort of texted her and said, what time are the flights from Heathrow? Like, is there a time that they stop? And apparently there are no flights from 11:30 until 6:00. So we thought, well, going to Heathrow is pointless.
We'll be stuck there.
We'll be stuck there. There'll be no, it won't even be busy, so it's not like we could convince someone to buy us a flight for the morning, because there'll be nobody there. Mm-hmm. So we thought it would be worth just going to Dover. If by the time that we decided to go to Dover, we'd been told by the organisers back in the base that the port was still open for going in, but sort of it was unsure about going out, but they kind of said, well, we don't know what's going to happen yet. And so we thought, well, we can go to Dover and always sit out there if the situation changes. So then we text them saying, like, we got a lift with this Bert. He took us all the way to Vienna.
Yeah.
He's just the guy that had to nap a few times towards the end.
I mean, it was brilliant to begin with. Yeah. And then sort of midway through Austria, he got quite tired. And then every service station,
he stopped
and had like 2 hours nap. Yeah. And then the next service station, and then another sleep. And then, so, like, when we got in, he was like, yeah, well, I'll be in Budapest by 8 p.m. 8 p.m. Saturday night.
Oh, really?
So we were like, that is incredible.
So you thought you were in Budapest.
So that's why, like, all the way we were fairly certain. And when we first called on the Saturday night, I think it was about 7-ish on a Saturday night, he said, oh, I miscalculated, it'll be about 10 p.m.
Yeah.
So by that point, we were still certain we'd be there by about 10 p.m.
Yeah.
And then you just sort of stopped waking up between there.
Tired,
and so by the time that... It was 6:30 for us, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So it was about 5:30 for you. We thought, right, well, this is going to have to do.
Yeah.
Because we were about 2 hours from Vienna.
Yeah. So.
I know, we're much further than that. Either way.
Yeah, you did really well to get as far as you did.
Yeah.
Where
so
did you
so
cross
we
in?
Just we te- we took went to this sign that was in the service station. We took a picture there, and so that was kind of the final destination that we did.
Yeah.
But like getting over Dover, when we got in the car. We got a phone call, like, as soon as we said, right, we've got a car, we're headed to Dover. Literally 30 seconds later, we had a phone call from Olivia, sort of saying, just to let you know, our new stance is we do not condone going into France. Nobody should go into
France. Did you go to Calais or Dunkirk?
We had to Dunkirk.
Yeah.
And so all the way in the car to Dover, we were like, because he needed to get to Budapest, so like we were sort of discussing with him, trying to think, you know, would it be easier for you? Because he hadn't even booked his ticket yet.
Okay.
Over the ferry. So we were like, well, if you haven't bought your ticket, is it worth going up to Harwich and getting the ferry over to Rotterdam? Mm-hmm. And he was like, maybe. But he was sort of unconvinced. And so we went to Dover and we were still unsure about what was happening. And the border control in Dover called Calais whilst we were stood there.
Oh, really?
And
to make sure.
Calais basically said, situation at the moment is only... the periphery around Paris is closed and the actual borders are still open despite what's being said on the news.
Yeah.
And so we called then the organisers back and they were saying, but the French president has just said this.
Yeah.
And we're like, but border control has just said
this.
Yeah.
More inclined to trust border control.
So we asked them what would happen if it changed whilst we were on the boat and they just said, well, I'll turn around and go back into Dover. So we would be no worse off.
Yeah. No, we might as well try.
So we gave it a go, and once we landed, like, it was a bizarre ferry,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Because it was very weird, because all over the news, they had like Paris, and we were heading to France.
Yeah.
So it was a bit.
And it just kept re-showing the clip, and this is on the ferry, it kept re-showing the clip of the president. Keep showing the clip of the president saying the borders are closed, the country's in lockdown, we're in a state of emergency.
I could see Dunkirk.
I've got a picture of the news on the telly, and then a window behind it, and out of the window is Dunkirk. And it's bizarre.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, once we were over, it was literally, as I said, it's the same driver.
Yeah.
And so once we actually landed in Dunkirk, I think we were out of France in about
half an hour,
45 minutes, because it's so close to the Belgian
border. It's really
quick,
isn't it? Because me and my teammate, we crossed from Portsmouth and got to a place called Cannes in North France.
Yeah.
And when we were telling the organisers that we were heading to France, they were like, we were advising against it.
Yeah.
But we thought, we're just going to stay away from Paris. So we just headed south and got a few hours south, and we were fine.
Were you the team that got to Cannes?
Yeah, we got to Cannes and then head down. We head like to a place near Tours called Saumur, and that's where we ended. But it was a weird feeling being in France when everything was going on. We took part in the minute silence in France for the attacks, which was weird to be a part of, but quite, it was nice. Yeah. Nice to be a part of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Would you do it again? What was the highlights for you?
I think I'd definitely do it again.
You would?
Yeah, I would. Definitely. It's quite nice to kind of, as you said to begin with, the journey going out, it's really nice to not have a destination and to not have any kind of plans, not have any kind of time constraints, and whatever happens, happens, and it's quite sort of freeing. But it did get kind of stressful on the way back when we were trying to get, had lectures on Monday.
To get back, and we were so tired by that point as well. So.
Yeah.
But overall, it was definitely worth doing. I definitely recommend doing it.
Brilliant. Well, thanks, guys. Thank you very much for joining us.
Awesome.
Congratulations and thank you for joining us, Alex and Kate. Unfortunately, that's all we have time for on today's show, but here's a quick look at what's coming up on campus next week.
Tonight, County Bar are hosting Live at the Oak from 7:30.
Also tomorrow night in County is the International Quiz.
Monday night sees the debate for BDS going on in Faraday from 6:30.
Big night out is tonight, so make sure you have your scarves.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week with more Good Morning Lancaster.